Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the latest in our Workplace Spotlight series, Veterans in the Workplace. We're excited all of you could join us today. My name is Karen Rasmussen, and I'll be introducing our speakers and periodically jumping into reviews and polls. We'll begin with a few housekeeping items, and then we'll get the presentation started. This is a live streaming event and is being recorded. We'll send you a link to the recording 24 hours after the webinar. To listen to the audio, please plug your headphones into your computer or smart device, or alternatively, make sure your speakers are turned up. While we will not be answering questions until the end of the webcast, time permitting, questions may be submitted anytime during the webcast by entering your question in the Q&A text field and clicking Submit. I would also like to encourage you to complete our short survey by clicking on the checklist survey icon at the bottom of the screen. And a PDF of this presentation is available for download, along with additional resources you may find useful, in the resource list next to the presentation slides. Today's webcast is certified for HRCI, SHRM, and CPE credit. For CPE credit, ADP partners with Wolters Kluwer for our CPE learning program. As a reminder, for those that want CPE credit, you will need to respond to all four polling questions that we will have throughout the session to qualify. And going to the link on the screen lets you manage all your courses and access your certificates. I would encourage you to download the presentation slides in the resource area as well, as we have an additional slide at the end to serve as instruction on how to access your certification. Lastly, before I introduce today's speakers, I just want to review our legal disclaimer. Today's presentation is not legal or tax advice. Before taking any actions on the information contained in this presentation, employers should review this material with their counsel. And keep in mind that what we're discussing today is not the final word on any of these topics. Regulations change and employers need to comply with current laws. And also, nothing is intended to be a political opinion. ADP has over 60,000 employees and over 600,000 clients across the political spectrum. Our role is to assist employers with their compliance responsibilities. And with that, I'd like to introduce today's speakers, Harris Morris and Jason Goroff. Harris is the Senior Director for ADP's Veterans Initiative Program. Upon his retirement from the U.S. Army after 22 years, Harris began his post-military career as a project manager in the financial industry. He took his experience in project and program management and then applied them to developing veteran-related programs within companies for the last 5 years. Harris also serves as the vice chair for the ADP Military Strong Business Resource Group. Jason is a veteran recruitment program manager and has 13 years of talent acquisition experience, leading both veteran hiring programs as well as talent acquisition teams. He has helped build out a brand new program for the leading veteran recruitment company in the last 2 years and has 14 years of total military experience in the U.S. Army. With that, Harris, I know you and Jason have a lot of content you'd like to talk about today, so I'm going to turn the event over to you.
Thank you, Karen. I appreciate it. Well, thank you. This is Harris Morris. Good afternoon to everyone on the line, and welcome to our discussion on veterans in the workplace. With Veterans Day approaching on 11 November, I cannot think of a better topic of discussion for us to touch on today. For those veterans who may be on the line today, thank you for your service from one veteran to another. As you can see from the topics, there's a lot to cover on our agenda today, which we could probably spend hours upon hours discussing. However, given our 60-minute window for today, Jason and I will be providing you with a high-level view of veterans in the workplace with hopes of providing future WebEx sessions to explore some of these topics a bit deeper. So for today's discussion, Jason and I plan on touching on the following. We will provide some understanding of the military profession and the military culture from which our veterans come. We will highlight some of the things that you should know about those who have served. We'll provide our personal stories of transition into corporate America to provide at least two different perspectives. We will talk about how you can effectively interview a veteran and understand the skills they could bring to your team. And finally, we will talk about what you can do as a manager or first-line leader to assist recently transitioned veterans. All right. Our first topic, understanding military profession and military culture. But before we jump into the material, I'd like to set up a polling question for everybody. So the question that hopefully you see in front of you now is, what percent of veterans have a bachelor's degree? Is it 3%, 7%, 12%, 18%, or 25%? We'll take about 30 seconds to respond to that, and then we'll be able to see the results.
Thank you so much, Harris. I'll just interject really quickly and give my CPE reminder for those of you that would like CPE credit to just give a few, make sure you respond to all four questions to qualify. And I give you all just several more seconds. Okay, Harris, you should be seeing the results on the screen now.
Perfect. So we have a wide range of numbers, and our correct answer is 18%. Actually, if we rounded it up, it's actually 18.6. But the main takeaway here is to let you know that a lot of our veterans have tremendous educational experience. And interestingly enough, there's some statistics out there around this that the veterans as a whole have a higher percentage of education level across all the different levels, whether it be a master's, associates, PhD, than their non-veteran counterparts. So just a piece of information there for everybody to think about as you think about veteran talent for your organizations. So let's jump into understanding the military profession and what our veterans are used to from what they do. Why is this so important? Given that our military is an all-voluntary force, the majority of our population have not served and may not be familiar with military life other than what they've seen in movies or read in the paper. These items are intended to help our audience that has not served better understand where veterans are coming from before they exit the service. So the top one I'll talk to you is this concept of meaning and purpose. Our veterans stand up to take an oath to support and defend the Constitution against all enemies. Whether they serve for 3 years or 30 years, they understand what it means to serve something bigger than themselves. There's no doubt about their passion and their purpose in life while serving their country. The trust and transparency. Given the nature of the work which our military does and the consequences of the actions that they take, the importance of trust and transparency in the military is critical. Our leaders in the military let their people know what they know, no matter what that story is. It's important that they understand, and there's 100% trust between the leaders and their individuals who they serve with. This concept of job versus profession. So I like to think of a job as somebody that works from 8 to 5 to get a paycheck, whereas the profession, our military members are spending hours and hours and hours, and you can see it even on the question below, 24/7 mentality. They're always on duty. They're always ready to go. The mission always comes first. I bring your attention to this concept of a clear chain of command. As you know, the military is a very hierarchical organization. And when you move to corporate America, a lot of times it's a matrix organization. It's very different when veterans show up in that there's so many different stakeholders that they're dealing with. So I share that with you as something to think about. The communication style in the military, I say that it's very direct, and there's a purpose and a reason for that. When the bullets are flying and things are occurring in a very hectic environment, people must be able to speak very short and precise in what they're talking about, and that's something that they're used to from their time in the military. Our veterans are all about the team. You know, I like to say that I is not in their vocabulary, but we is definitely in their vocabulary. And for those of you that may have been out there and spoken to veterans, either in interviewing, et cetera, you will know that they will talk about we and not necessarily I. I also bring to your attention the fact that a lot of our veterans joined the military during their very formative years, 18 to 24, and the values that they build within the military while they're serving during those formative years are critical, and they become the foundation of who they become and what they will be in the future. And finally, I'd like to talk about the importance of lessons learned. Our military evaluates everything that they do to be better at every step of the way. They're a learning organization, and it's their goal to get better every day. And so our veterans are very used to being critical and looking at how things are being done, how can they be done better, and making sure that everybody knows and that we're making the team the best that we can. Okay. Over to you, Jason.
Thank you, Harris. Thank you to everyone who joined today. I'm going to touch on a topic about things to know about those who have served in the military. Before that, we have another poll question for you. What percentage of the active duty military is female? 5%, 11%, 17%, 27%, or 35%? We'll give you about 30 seconds to answer that question.
Thank you so much, Jason. And I'm going to quickly interject my second CPE reminder to make sure that those of you that would like CPE credit to please make sure you respond to the question to qualify. I'm going to give you all a few more seconds. Okay, Jason, you should be seeing the results on the screen now.
Thank you. The result was 17% is the highest, and that is also the correct answer. Thank you, everyone, for answering that question. We're going to talk about 15 things to know about those who served in the military, and this is something that one of our partners, PsychArmor Institute, they're really good at putting together different trainings for human resources, for recruiters, for hiring managers. This is a survey that they conducted with many service members, and the subjects below are what the service members, what the veterans want you as employers to know about them. This is what is most important to them. First thing is they want you to know that we are not all soldiers. And I think that that's something common that we hear in the media, in TV shows, as people in the military always refer to as soldiers. Well, in the Army, that's true. You also have airmen from the Air Force, seamen from the Navy, Marines from the Marine Corps, Coast Guardsmen. So not everyone is a soldier. Also, you'll come across folks that serve in the reserve component, to include the National Guard. That is part of the military. It may not be full-time, but the reserve and the National Guard are just as important as the active duty military, and in fact have been extremely important since the events of 9/11, where they have been called up multiple times to support operations overseas. Not everyone in the military is infantry. What that means is not every military member is involved in what we call combat arms. You have people that are medics. You have people that work in information technology, truck drivers. There are hundreds of different jobs in the military. Some people choose to be in combat arms, but not everyone. Military has leaders at every level in the chain of command. What's important to take away from here is that you may be hiring someone who only did 4 years in the military. They may have joined at 18 years old, got out in their early 20s. At that point, they have already had experience leading. which is a great advantage for your organization because you can take someone who is forced into a leadership position at a very young age and had to become very proficient at it. As Harris mentioned before, military members wish people knew that during their time in the military, they are always on duty. There really isn't such thing as a vacation. There have been people that go home on leave during the holiday season and wind up getting a phone call that they have to report back to base because they may be getting deployed. I know quite a few people that happened to. There really isn't ever time off. Middle of the night, you may get called into work. Veterans also think it's important that you understand that they take pride in their appearance and conduct. This is something that's instilled in them at the very beginning of their service, their first week of basic training. The way that they conduct themselves, both in and out of uniform, their personal appearance to ensure that they look like a professional, that's very important. Common misconception and one thing that you shouldn't be asking folks in the workplace anyway, and we unfortunately still hear it, is that question, did you kill someone? Veterans wish that more civilians who never served in the military knew to not ask that question. This is a big one here, and I think part of it is from the media, from the news, from some movies and TV shows out there. It seems like every time I watch a TV program and there's a veteran, that veteran has PTSD and they're crazy and causing some sort of an issue. Not all veterans have PTSD. In fact, studies show that PTSD is more prevalent in the general population of the country, regardless of serving in the military or not. There are, unfortunately, some folks that do have PTSD, and it's important to know that it's not a condition that makes them dangerous or violent in the workplace. And even more importantly, it's something that is identified before leaving the military, so most of those folks are being treated for it. I've heard of too many situations where people are afraid to hire a veteran because of this misconception that we all have PTSD. It's not true. And if someone does have it, they're being treated for it, and you're no more likely to have a veteran employee cause an issue of violence in the workplace than anyone else. Veterans also want you to know it's hard to ask for help. And this is especially true in the workplace. There's a lot of pride that veterans have. They want to come in, work at your company, and show that they could be the best that they can be. Sometimes you have to reach out to them and see if they need help. It's very hard for a veteran to put aside their pride and ask for that help. Military service changes us. I would say for most people, the better. A lot of folks that I served with didn't necessarily have a direction in their life. Majority of people that I served with made a decision at a very young age that they wanted to serve, and it changes us for the better. It teaches us a lot of skills that you just can't possibly learn without serving in the military. We differ in how we identify with the military after we leave active duty. There's always a sense of belonging. Most of us, not a day goes by that we don't think about the fact that we're no longer in the military. And that's where employers can come in and help add that sense of purpose. You know, the next mission in life after leaving the military is finding meaningful work. Our families serve with us. This is a big one that a lot of folks don't realize. It's not just the service member that's serving. It's the military spouse. They arguably have a more difficult job. The person that they're married to may be on deployment. They know where they are. The spouse doesn't. The spouse is also responsible for taking care of everything at home. So it becomes a whole family way of life. We would die for each other and for our country. That's something that we decided to do before we raised our right hand and took an oath to join the military. And everyone who joined, joined for one reason, to serve something more important than ourselves. And I think that's very important when you think about bringing veterans to your organization especially after 9/11, there are a lot of folks out there who, rightfully so, did not want to put themselves in danger. But then there are other folks out there who made a clear decision, look, there is something that happened here. We love our country. We want to make sure that this way of life that we have stays. We want to ensure that our freedom continues. So we are going to join the military and do our part. I'm not going to go through all of these here, but this is a great study done by the IVMF, the Institute for Veterans and Military Families at Syracuse University. One of the biggest takeaways here is that veterans are entrepreneurial. They have a high level of resiliency, and they're really cross-cultural, team-driven individuals. And what's so interesting about that is when you hire a veteran, you'll notice that they've already had that experience working with diverse people from all over the country. They're used to team building. So you're bringing in someone who really is not just an individual, but someone that's used to focusing and working together as a team.
Excellent.
Sorry, Harris, go ahead.
No, it's good. Thanks, Jason. So what we'd like to do now is Jason and I would like to be able to talk about our experiences as we made our way into corporate America. We took different paths to get there, but I think it's always good to understand what our veterans have and the journey that they have been on. Before we jump into our stories, I just would want to share one note with you. You'll see where it says find veterans in your organization and ask them about their transition experience. You will hear our two stories today, but every company and every job will be slightly different. Everybody's journey is slightly different. And so I would tell you, go back and ask and find those veterans in your organizations and talk to them and learn more about the challenges that they did have to endure as they made those changes. So I will go ahead and, start with myself and my story. And I got married probably 10 years into my time in the military. And when I got married, I kind of made a promise to my wife that I was going to move back to where she was from, which was New Jersey. And so I kind of made a commitment that geography was going to drive my next step in life. I was close to New York City in a large metropolitan area that had lots of jobs, but I was able to do that. I was also very fortunate that I lived very close on my final assignment in the military to where it was that I was going to be starting my next chapter of my life. I had been in the military for 22 years and can honestly say that I had never even walked into a quote-unquote civilian company until I went for my first interviews. It was, to say the least, a very strange world for me, as I can imagine it would be if I dropped those of you who may not have been in the military into an Army tank or infantry unit after you've worked in corporate America for 22 years. It's a challenge. The difference is that every veteran is going to have to get out of the military at some point and go on this journey to figure out where they go next. So when I got out, I found myself moving, obviously, from a relatively senior position of authority in the military where I was making senior decisions and providing direction for, large teams, to a position as an individual contributor where I understood that there was a lot that I had to learn about corporate America, But it was tough. In the military, I normally had the final word on things that were going to happen. And in this new world, I felt that I had little to no voice. And so I had to reconcile that for myself. That was something that took a while. And you know, I probably still think about it from time to time. You know, I would be lying to you if I said that transition is an easy thing. And I can recall many times in which I would talk with my wife saying, I think I made a mistake getting out of the military. But the truth is, we do all get out of the military at some point, and we must begin that next chapter of our lives. And the trying to figure out what that next step is something that, you know, sometimes our service members work right up until their last day, and they just never put enough thought into what they want to do next. There's a lot of things they could do, but they're probably not real good at translating that and being able to tell folks that story. Few other nuggets just that I would share with everybody. You know, I definitely felt at the time that I got out of the military that there was a certain amount of loss of purpose and meaning in my life. It was very easy being in the military to know that you're working for something bigger than yourself. You're always giving. It's servant leadership. And, you know, that was something that I had to work through on my own. Another challenge for me was that I honestly felt like I was using maybe 20% of my skills, while 80% of my skills, you know, that may have been managing teams and providing direction and guidance and mentoring others, were not really being used. And so, you know, I had a lot more to offer in my tool bag, but I felt that my role did not always provide me with those opportunities. At the same time, you know, I realized it was a time of great growth in just adjusting to the differences that existed in corporate America. For me, you know, the best support that I received as I was transitioning was talking to other veterans at the company who had successfully transitioned and were there to help guide me, if you will, through the trials and tribulations. They had all been there, and I appreciated their guidance and help in doing those things. And the last thing I would share before turning over to Jason, I would just say that, you know, transition doesn't happen in days or weeks or months. I believe that it takes years to truly get those things that were very military out and to just over time acclimate to the new world you find yourself. And so, you know, I've been now out for just over 7 years, and I would tell you I still am transitioning even at this point. So I hope that's helpful to everyone. Over to you, Jason.
Thanks, Harris. You've done well with yourself, though.
Thank you.
So I like to tell my story, especially to a lot of folks that are transitioning out of the military now. I volunteer a lot of my time in different groups, working with veterans that are a year, 6 months, 3 months out from transitioning from the service, or some of them that recently transitioned, because I can tell you everything not to do when getting out of the military. If it was the wrong thing to do, I did it. So I didn't spend as much time in the Army as Harris did. I did about 14 years. And when I got out, I thought, based on some of the classes that the military gives you, I thought I would walk out the door, put on a suit, and walk right in another door in corporate America the next day. I was wrong. I started applying for jobs that I was not even closely qualified for. And I know this now, you know, it's kind of funny looking back on it, but I thought I was. I was told from the classes that I took leaving the military that I would be qualified for them. And it just wasn't happening. Interview after interview, I would go into these interviews, and I made the mistake of being a little bit too arrogant. The last thing I did in the Army was recruiting duty. So I thought that I would be able to step right into that in the civilian world, and I would go on these interviews and essentially tell the hiring managers how easy their job was. Probably not the best way to get hired, and that was one of the mistakes that I made. I didn't know any better. I thought that being a military recruiter was extremely difficult, and it was, but I made a false assumption that it was a more difficult job than what we deal with in talent acquisition on the civilian side. So I would go into these interviews extremely arrogant and couldn't figure out why, you know, I wasn't getting any return phone calls. 5 months of this went by. Spent some time hanging drywall, just doing what I needed to do, until finally I realized I needed to tone it down a little bit, especially after talking to some of my friends who had already left and listening to some of the challenges that they had. Went on an interview with a staffing company here in the New York area, and I will forever be grateful to them. They were the first ones that gave me an opportunity and really helped bridge the gap in skills that I learned between the military and what I have to do now. So one of the big key words of advice I like to give people that are transitioning these days is start doing it early. Start networking a year before you're getting ready to get out. Don't be like me. Don't wait until the very last minute and then have that major gap. And I'm lucky. It was only 5 months. I know people that, you know, have left over a year ago and still can't find an opportunity. And make sure that, you know, you understand what you bring to an organization and be able to explain it. That's a topic that Harris and I could probably spend about 2 hours covering, so obviously we don't have time to do that today. But that was my experience, and you know, if anyone does know of anyone that needs some guidance, please feel free to have them connect with me, and I'll be more than happy to walk them through my transition and what not to do. Back to you, Harris. Or is it me? It is me.
There you go.
The next subject we're going to discuss today, and again, this is one that could probably be a whole webinar in itself, is interviewing veterans. And this is one of the biggest challenges that we see is getting the actual decision maker to understand the differences in interviewing veterans when it comes to a comparison of folks that they normally would interview that have not served in the military. Poll question for you all. How many service members depart the U.S. military each year? 25,000, 75,000, 200,000, 500,000, or more than a million? I'll give you 30 seconds to answer that.
Thank you so much, Jason, and thank you so much, both of you, for sharing your stories. I'm sure it's very valuable from an employer, you know, perspective, you know, to see how it is from the veterans' perspective, for sure. And I'm going to give my third CPE reminder for those of you that would like CPE credit. So please make sure you respond to the question to qualify. Give you all just a few more seconds. Okay, Jason, you should be seeing the results on the screen now. You're seeing the results there, Jason?
I am. I had my phone on mute. I'm sorry about that.
The
results
okay,
are...
No problem.
200,000, like most of you said, and that's really important to remember. You have, as employers, 200,000 service members leaving the military each year. And, you know, right now, obviously, there are more jobs than candidates out there, but still there seems to be an issue with service members being able to get themselves into the right job. One of the things that we always recommend is taking a real different approach to understanding the skills that a veteran may bring to your organization. If you look at someone, for instance, who may not have a job that is directly transferable to a civilian job, they still bring other skills with them. An example would be, like we spoke about earlier, folks who come from combat arms. There's obviously not a job comparable to infantry in the civilian world, but there are a lot of soft skills that an infantry member brings with them. Leadership, being able to work under high amounts of stress, that's just a few. But that's what we look at when we want to interview veterans, is uncovering some of those skills. Understand that veterans are not great when it comes to talking about themselves. You'll notice when you ask a veteran a question directly about their own experience, they're always going to respond with "we." And a lot of hiring managers don't understand that. You know, the question was, tell me about something that you did. Veterans struggle with that. It's all about working together as a team. It's all about teamwork. And that's advice that we have to constantly give veterans when they're interviewing, is be prepared to answer questions strictly about what you've done. There's also a need to be patient, especially when you're interviewing someone who just got out of the military. They will tend to, even though they understand they shouldn't, they will tend to use military terms and jargon. It's just second nature when you've been doing it 24/7, 365 for an extended period of time. They may still do it. If you don't understand what they said, feel free to ask. They'll quickly realize that they threw some military jargon at you, and they'll be more than happy to help you understand it. One of the best ways to handle this is, if you're interviewing a veteran, find another veteran in your organization and invite them to the interview. They can help steer the conversation, really dig into what the veteran is trying to say and get them to speak more about it, and help uncover, you know, how valuable those skills really are. When someone is interviewing and they don't have that experience, they may not fully be able to uncover that. You also may want to put some more time into your interview questions. Ask some more open-ended questions. This really helps the veteran explain what they've done. Again, veterans tend to be, like Harris mentioned earlier, very short in their response. It's just, you know, their nature. Open-ended questions allow them to elaborate and really give them the opportunity to talk about themselves. And that's one of the struggles that we see, is that veterans are so quick to give an answer with a closed-ended question, that an open-ended question really allows them to get excited and elaborate. Before you interview a veteran, you should also understand the types of questions that you can ask them. And this all falls under USERRA. USERRA protects the rights of veterans and those who are still in the National Guard and Reserve. You know, believe it or not, there's certain questions such as, what rank were you, or where have you served, are questions that we can't ask for a variety of different reasons. So make sure that you're certainly covering yourself and checking into that beforehand. And also ask the veteran about any additional jobs that they have done outside of their MOS or military job. What's very interesting is that most folks in the military hold a primary job, but also have what we call, in the Army anyway, SQIs, special skill identifiers. So these may be anything, you know, some examples would be trainer, physical fitness trainer, recruiter, any special duty type of station. So you may have someone that fixed helicopters, but also is considered a dietitian. They went to the Army dietitian class and became the point of contact in their assigned unit to ensure that their other service members stayed in shape. So don't be afraid to ask, you know, what other additional jobs the veteran had while they were in service. And now I'm going to turn it over to Harris to talk more about the retention piece.
Excellent. Thanks, Jason. It's great, great comments and great insight into how we can do things better with our veterans when interviewing. So you hired a recently transitioned veteran, now what? But before we jump into that, let's go ahead and do another polling question. The question you should see in front of you is, what percent of the total U.S. population has served in the military? Is it 0.4%, 3%, 10%, or 20%? We'll give 30 seconds for you to respond.
Thank you, Harris. And I'm going to interject my last CPE reminder. For those of you that would like CPE credit, to please make sure you respond to the question to qualify. If you have any issues, feel free to put your answer in the Q&A text field as well, and we can record it there. Give you just a few more seconds. Okay, Harris, you should be seeing the results. Oh, wait one second. They went away from me for a minute. There, you should be seeing the results on the screen now.
All right. So we have almost an equal number across the board here. The actual correct answer is 0.4% of the population currently is serving within our military. Excellent. So let's jump in with the time that remains here and talk on our final topic. So you hired a recently transitioned veteran, now what? One of the biggest things, and I hope some of the things that I had talked about earlier, talked about the challenges that we as veterans have. Not everybody has the same experience. Some people are different. But what I have found is there's a few things that our employers can do to assist our veterans once they start up. The first one is getting them to join a military employee resource group or business resource group, ERG, BRG, depending on your company. Maybe you're a smaller company and you don't have something like that. Figure out who those veterans are and get new veterans that join your company and get them connected with that other individual. What I have found is it provides an audience for you to, you know, ask those questions you may be embarrassed to ask of your manager. The military BRGs also provide a very important component which our veterans lose upon departing the military, and that is that purpose. We talked about service and having a purpose. One of the things that the BRGs do is they go out into the local community and they make a difference through, you know, nonprofit work and things of that nature, working with nonprofits to fill that void that a lot of our veterans have. And the next item down you'll see is assign them a buddy or a mentor. Ideally, it's an individual who has served but has successfully made the transition to corporate America. You know, as I moved around the military, it was 12 times I moved in 22 years. And every time I arrived at a new assignment, I was given a buddy who would help me and welcome me to that new installation, new country, wherever it was that I was. And they would show me ropes a little bit. And I would tell you that that's a very valuable thing, especially for those that are just getting out and they're still trying to find their legs and understand the changes and the differences that they're going through. This person, it's important, you know, that they're somebody else in the company, not necessarily part of, you know, their chain of command, if you will, but somebody in another part of the business, somebody that's somewhere else that can just help them, and they, our veterans can feel free to speak with them. You'll see, help them find meaning and purpose in the work they are doing. Just like the BRGs can help fill that void, I would tell the hiring managers out there, think about the work that the individual is doing. They need to find a new purpose, and you can be somebody that can help them understand what that new purpose is and help them start to grow, right? Start to understand where they fit into the organization, which is the next bullet down you see. In the military, our veterans always knew, our service members always knew, you know, what they were doing. They knew what the next level up was doing. They knew what the level above that was doing. They knew what was happening to their left and right. And sometimes in corporate America, we'll find that, you know, you're just in your little world and you don't know where you fit into the bigger machine, if you will, that your organization does. And so it's helpful to provide them with a bigger context to feel, you know, what they're used to feeling about what they do. You know, maybe you grab somebody as a manager and just have them walk around with you for a whole day or 2 days and let them see what's going on everywhere else. Help them understand the bigger picture that's out there. So I hope that helps with helping to understand some of the things that can be done. Here's a few more. And this is, again, very important. Talked early on about the importance of our veterans and that they're very much about improving. They're always going through lessons learned and things of that nature. So they've got pretty thick skin coming out of the military. They're used to being told that they did something wrong. Here's how you improve it. And everybody in the military goes through that, regardless of what branch you're in of the service. And so you as a manager, it's important to provide them with feedback, timely feedback, consistent feedback that will help them understand how they're viewed and what they can do to improve. And I can assure you that they want to improve. There's nothing that they want more. They want to be the best at everything they do. And so I would just ask you to maybe do it a little bit more often than you may for other employees who may have a little bit more understanding of your industry or the things that you're doing. You know, do it a weekly, do it twice a week. You know, whatever it is they're getting out. Help them understand what comes next. And I mean this from a career progression standpoint, and it might not be in their initial days or weeks or months, but help them understand what is the next thing for them in this organization. In the military, they understood career progression. They knew exactly what jobs they had to hold. They knew exactly what types of things they needed to do to get promoted and to get to move on to the next level of leadership. In corporate America, there's a different concept in which sometimes we move left or right before we go up. And that's kind of a foreign concept to a lot of military because it is an up or out type of organization in general. And so understand that about the veterans and help them in order to understand that a bit better. Set challenging goals. The veterans, like I said, they're task-oriented, and they have a high need for achievement. So, you know, I talked about myself. Stretch them. Give them things. Let them use some of those skills that they have that maybe they're not using in the role that they were hired for, but they certainly have the ability to do. Allow them that opportunity. Give them stretch assignments. Give them something and understand what those other skills are that they bring. As a manager, I think it's in your best interest and the interest of the team and the organization to maximize and bring everything that veteran has to offer to help the organization as a whole. And then finally, provide your veteran with a role model to model themselves after. In the military, you know, over time, you know who the best soldier or sailor or airman might be that's out there. Because they've proven themselves, and everybody knows it. Here in corporate America, they don't necessarily – there's different things that are appreciated. There's different things that our organizations care about. And so helping a veteran
show them what right looks like in corporate America will go a long way towards helping them progress and move into the way that and places that they would like to get to. So that finishes up the last portion of our training. And so we thought it best to at least come up with some key takeaways. And like we said, we have talked about a lot of things today, but these are probably the summary, if you will, of what you should take back to your organizations and think about. It's important for you to understand the military culture and understand that the veterans who are coming out of the military are team-oriented and the mission comes first. They will amaze you with the things that they can do if you just give them that opportunity and you understand that that's where they're coming from. What the veterans bring to corporate America, the values that were built into them as a young 18 to 24 and beyond year old, their foundation was built through their time in the service. Things like commitment, leadership, working well under pressure, trustworthy. They have an amazing ability for transferable skills into a lot of different industries, even though they may differ from what they did in the military. And they certainly are adaptable. From the perspective of interviewing veterans who you're considering bringing into your organization, understand that terminology may be different for them, and they don't speak civilianese, and help them translate the things that they're doing so that you truly understand exactly what they bring and how they can help your team. Consider including a veteran in that interview process who can help be a translator. And finally, how can you help a newly hired veteran? Without a doubt, providing consistent and direct feedback are critical to their growth and to what they will become. And sometimes it's hard for, I think, our hiring managers to go out there and be very straight, but I can assure you that our veterans are very thick-skinned and they want that feedback from you, so please provide that to them and get them a mentor, somebody that can help them walk through that point of transition. So that concludes what we are hoping to talk to you about today. Back over to you, Karen.
Thank you so much, Harris, and thank you so much, Jason, for sharing your stories and for all that valuable information for employers to take away with them. I think we do have time for a few questions. We did get some good ones from the audience. I'd like to ask you guys, since we do have the time. Jason, I'm going to direct this first one to you, which is I have heard about veteran underemployment being a problem. Can you discuss this issue a bit more?
Yeah, great question. That's a whole other webinar in itself. So the good part is right now we're seeing veteran unemployment at an all-time low. 3-4 years ago, it was extremely high. Right now, it's at the lowest it's ever been. But what the negative part is we're seeing veterans being put into the wrong job, and that's caused a retention issue. There was a study recently by IVMF, we had referenced them before, that 80% of veterans are leaving their first job in the first year. Reason for that is we're seeing a lot of veterans that are panicked when they're leaving the service, thinking that they need to take the first job that's available. What the real cause, though, is organizations not really seeing the true skill that the veteran has. And what winds up happening is you have someone like Harris, who was a senior officer, being brought into a civilian organization, used to leading people, used to making decisions, and not being able to do that right away. And what's happening is veterans are accepting that first job offer, getting their foot in the door, the company that they're with. And I won't say all companies. There are some companies out there who are very good at recognizing the skills that veterans bring, but some of them are not. And those veterans are just waiting for another opportunity, and unfortunately they take off. So basically we're seeing veterans getting hired, but into a role that's below their skill level.
Okay, great. Thank you for sharing that, Jason. Harris, I'm going to punt the second one to you. And this is a question on BRGs, which maybe not everyone on the phone is familiar with. So can you talk about, you know, how do BRGs help veterans? I know you are vice chair for the one here at ADP. So could you talk about them a bit more?
Sure. And I think I've touched on a few of these things. So at ADP, we have a veterans group. We've got, you know, 22 chapters of our Military Strong Business Resource Group across the United States. And you know, it's important as we think about these groups, it's made up of both veterans as well as allies. And those individuals who are friendly towards the military population, maybe they had a family member that served, their parents may have served, a brother, sister, whatever. And so they understand a little bit more about what service means, and they become a tremendous tool that our veterans are able to leverage once they get to, you know, their first job, their first company. I would also tell you that depending on the size of the company, there are many other business resource groups that are out there as well. And so I think it's always important to, you know, as you come to a new company, to build as large a network as you possibly can. And so I caution people to, you know, while it's important to find that veteran and have somebody that you can talk to, don't make that exclusively the only place that you as a veteran would be in. Encourage those veterans to go be a part of other business resource groups and get differing opinions and meet new people across the business. I think it's really important, and the BRGs can have a tremendous impact on, you know, achieving, helping to recruit other veterans. It's just amazing what these groups do for us at ADP, and so hopefully that touches on it. But yeah, great question. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Maybe let's try to squeeze in just one more before we have to go. And this can be for either of you, whoever feels comfortable answering it. So someone asked, are there specific recruiting companies that work with employers and veterans to help the vet find a job?
Yeah, I could probably take that one, Harris.
Sure.
There are. There are organizations out there that that are similar to staffing companies that are, you know, specific to veterans. More and more starting to pop up. Even here at ADP, part of our RPO division, we do that. We have a group that helps our clients find veterans and actually put together a whole military program. But yeah, there are groups like Bradley Morris, Lucas Group, other organizations that focus specifically on sourcing veterans for open roles.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Jason. And again, both of you for all that valuable information. So unfortunately, based on timing, this does conclude our event for today. Your HRCI and SHRM credit information will be included in the thank you for attending email. And if you requested CPE credit when you registered, you should be able to access your CPE credit using the instructions in the presentation within 24 to 48 hours. And on behalf of Harris, Jason, myself, and the entire team at ADP, we thank you for joining us today, and we look forward to having you join us for future Workplace Spotlight events. Thank you again, and have a great rest of your day.